Hello, and welcome to Made by Hand. I'm your host, Tiffany Peterson. Today, we're exploring the art of felting, and not just any kind of felting. We're going to learn the age-old method of wet felting. With us today is contemporary felt artist, Sara Smelt. Thank you, Sara, for being with us today.
You're welcome. Thank you for inviting me.
Tell us, what goes into making felt?
Okay, well, it's nothing like the little synthetic squares you get at the craft store. So real felting or traditional felting, you start with sheep wool or other animal fibers and add soap and water and a little bit of rubbing, a little bit of friction, and the wool fibers tangle and turn into felt fabric.
Really?
Yeah.
That is so, like, kind of a magical process.
Magical is the word, yeah. Yeah. All of these things started out looking like this.
Oh, wow. Well, let's get started. I'm so excited. What's our first step today for felting our bowl?
Well, this is merino wool, which is a sheep wool. It's really easy to felt. So what we're going to do first of all is unroll this and divide it into four pieces lengthways. And that's just going to help you to lay your fibers evenly.
Okay.
Okay.
There we go.
And then we're going to be laying the fibers on this template, which is a craft foam template. It's a little bit flexible because as the wool felts, it's going to shrink up and we want this to fold with our wool, with our felt.
Gotcha.
And we're using the template. We're going to lay the wool both sides of this template so that we're going to make a hollow object.
Oh, I see.
Yeah, that's how you do it. This is also known as a resist, and it actually resists the two sides of the wool from felting together.
Oh, that makes perfect sense.
Yeah, absolutely. You use the same technique to make bags or hats or even the coat. At the back is made with a really big resist.
Oh, very big template.
Yeah.
Oh, cool. Okay, so what do we do with this beautiful wool?
Okay, well, you're going to hold the wool about 4 inches back, just loosely in your left hand.
Okay.
And put the tips of the wool between your fingertips and the heel of the palm of your hand. And just pull, and it should just slide out. Perfect, really nice.
Oh.
So lay that in the top of your template, and then you're going to keep pulling and slightly overlap as you go down the template. Okay, you want to slightly overlap your fibers.
No,
nice.
Overlap.
Yeah, that's looking really good.
Great.
And we're going to build three columns going across the template.
Okay.
Okay, don't worry if your purple shows through because we're going to have eight different sides, four layers of this.
Okay. Oh, wow. You can tell you've done this before. You are fast.
You're doing pretty well.
Oh, wow. Okay. So this wool, is this sheep's wool?
Yeah, this is sheep's wool. You can use different animal fibers, alpaca, llama, can even use cat and dog if you
really
fancy doing that.
I'm going to shave my dog and make a bowl.
Yeah, I'm not going to go there. But.
And can you do this with human hair? Like human?
You can. The human, do you know what the human form of felt is?
What is that?
Dreadlocks.
Oh, that makes perfect sense.
Yeah. I told a man one time that his hair was felted, and he was we had a long chat about it. So now we're going to add wool around the outside and make like a sunshine. So we're going to lay the fibers half on and half off the template.
Oh, I see.
And what that's going to allow us to do when we flip the template over, we're going to fold these fibers round, and that's going to make a seamless hollow object.
I see.
Okay, so you won't see any kind of edge to our bowl.
So every single thing that was felted started with some kind of template and some type of layer of layer of layer of wool after wool after wool?
Yeah, that's right. Traditional felting is all wool, or there's a newer form of felting, Nuno felting, and that in that you mix wool and silk and you can get beautiful textures, and that's what the jacket is. That's a little bit more advanced.
Now
so you're
going to
do a little sunshine
in the
center as well.
Oh, I love
to
this.
To even up this first side.
I love that it's called a sunshine, too. So great.
That's a technical term.
Great. It is.
Okay, now we're going to take our synthetic nylon netting, and this is just sheer curtain material. Most of the equipment in felting is super cheap and easy to find.
Perfect.
Okay, and then you're going to take your spray bottle that's filled with warm to hot water. And some dish soap.
And some dish soap.
You don't really need fancy soap. Dish soap is fine. And we're going to spray it over the surface.
Okay.
And you want to make it wet. It's not going to felt if it's not wet.
Okay.
So,
be generous.
A few sprays, yeah.
All right.
Okay, and then first we're just going to press straight down and just a little jiggle.
jiggle.
And even that is going to start tangling the fibers.
Really? Kay? Already?
Yeah, you're going to see a transformation really, really quickly.
Usually soap untangles.
That's true. It actually opens up the scales on the surface of the fibers, and then we're going to rub now in little circles.
Okay.
So by doing that, we're actually tangling. Like if you rubbed your hair, it would tangle it.
Right.
That's what we're doing to the wool fibers.
I don't know anything about tangly hair. My hair is quite a tangle.
So you're going to start seeing wool coming through, and that's because the fibers are moving about and tangling with one another, and they're actually trying to felt to the netting. So we don't want to do this for too long, but just to...
Will it felt to the netting?
Eventually it will. You're kind of Nuno felting. Yeah, so you don't want it to completely attach.
Okay.
But just a minute or so, and we will be able to take the netting off.
Oh, wow.
Okay. So just little circles. Okay, that's probably good enough because we're going to do it on each layer separately. Okay. So then we're gently going to gonna brush down the wool as we take the nylon netting.
Okay, there we go. Brush, brush, brush.
Okay, and you can see that already the wool's kind of changed form.
Oh, yes.
You see it's not wool anymore. It's kind of turned into a very weak felt. Those fibers have tangled already. So we're going to flip this template over. And we're going to wrap these rays onto this side. And again, that's what's going to make it seamless.
Such a beautiful sunshine.
Okay, so that's your first side done.
Okay.
Then you're going to do exactly the same thing again to create a second side and completely enclose that template. So here's one I did earlier with it completely enclosed.
Very cool. Okay.
So you're a pro now. You can.
I know.
Lay
I'm
going to
get started.
Layer.
So you do the same. You do the one. Two, three columns?
Yeah,
and then the starburst?
The sunshine and the, yeah, absolutely.
Okay. And how many steps is there total for how many layers we lay of wool down?
This is pretty thick, so we're going to lay 8 different sides or 4 complete layers. Okay. And we'll do a couple, we'll do 4 sides of gold, and then we'll change to another color for the outside layers.
Oh, cool. Different color. All right. This is fantastic.
Is it making sense? Can you see how this is going to turn into a bowl?
I do, slowly. Yeah, my wheels are turning. Like, wow. Just tangling fabric.
You're pretty quick.
Well, I'm trying to beat you.
No chance.
Okay. So, I think as we are doing this, and we lay down the next 5 layers of wool, we're going to take a break and visit another artist working in an age-old craft, Luke Haynes. Luke is an alum of the artist residency program at 1450 Ocean. He travels the world showing his work and teaches on form, function, and design through fabric. Let's go take a look at his studio. We are at the Brewery Artist Lofts with quilt artist Luke Haynes. This is your beautiful Artist Loft studio.
Thank you.
Luke, what is a quilt artist?
Oh gosh, well, in my case, I'm using quilt as the language and method for making work. So I'm an artist and designer, but I'm using the quilt language and the sort of history of quilting to make the objects I make for the exhibitions and ideas that I'm trying to work with. Well, so my background is architecture. So I studied design and hyper-functional environment, as well as sort of all actions you take in making something have to be very purposeful. And so that's kind of the architecture that I bring to quilting. The difference really is only scale, because quilting is about something that you inhabit, but just personally, whereas a building, you know, it's still, you inhabit it, but the scale is much different. And so the same ideas overlap, the material, the function, the history, and any number of sort of design prompts that might create the object, but the scale is really just the only difference.
Can you show us your studio and
sure.
show us the big room,
yeah,
the big machine in there?
Well, come on in.
When did you get this machine?
Gosh, I got this one a little under a year ago. It's my first new machine that I've ever got.
No way!
The one before that was 37 years old, so.
Oh, wow.
Yeah,
that's great.
Quite an upgrade, really.
Is this a giant sewing machine?
Yeah, it is exactly that. It's a huge sewing machine.
What?
Turned sideways, so you're able to use the machine to do the drawing on top of the quilt. So you'll pin the quilt into these leader fabrics, and then you're actually moving the sewing machine on these tracks rather than pushing the quilt through the sewing machine itself. So what you're able to do is get so much more detailed work and through the entire quilt rather than having to kind of roll it and shove it under your small domestic sit-down.
Can you show us how this works?
Yeah, there's no fabric in it now, though.
Oh, okay. I just kind of want to fly it like a jet.
Yeah, well, I mean, I'm happy to pin something in there if you'd like. And the background is all youth clothes and the way that I make clothes. And...
Did you say the background is all used clothes?
Mm-hmm, yeah.
So, is that, you just said that's how you make your clothes?
Yeah, I mean, all of this is youth clothing as well.
Oh my goodness. So you take recycled clothes,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And you make all of your clothes through recycled clothing?
Yeah, exactly. And so this project on the wall is interesting because the figure on it is made from the clothes she was wearing when she sat for the portrait. So
no.
The background is all used clothes from her area, and then she's actually made from her own clothing.
That is so cool. Luke, is all of this, are all these finished?
Yeah, these are all finished pieces between shows or after shows or this kind
yeah.
of thing. This is what's nice about being a quilt artist is this is my warehouse.
Perfect.
Yeah, so this is, you know, any number of exhibitions.
It'll stored. Keep you warm in the winter.
Yeah, exactly. My friends say, gosh, it's never bad to go visit your quilter friends. You know?
Yeah, exactly. And speaking of shows, where can people see your work?
Gosh, so I have touring shows constantly around the world. I've got pieces in the Brooklyn Museum, in the Newark Museum. I've got some upcoming pieces for the California Folk Art Museum. And then there's just different galleries and exhibition spaces around the country, around the world that come and go.
Very cool.
Yeah.
Very cool. Great. Well, thank you so much, Luke,
yeah.
for having us in your studio.
Yeah,
it's been absolutely
by.
Beautiful. Can't wait to see more.
Yeah. Well, thanks very much.
Thank you. I have such a deeper respect for quilt making. It's interesting how Luke has taken a humble art form with a long history and added something very contemporary and new. So fun. And we're back in the studio with Sara Smelt, felting our bowls, and we're ready for our next step. So this is after you have already, we've already done the 8 layers.
We've done 7 sides,
layers.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So we did the 2 together,
yes.
And then we did another 2 gold layers, and then we did 3 mixing the 2 reds, okay? And you can actually decorate side 7 and 8 at the outside of your bowl. You can decorate both sides, but I'm just going to show you one side because
okay.
I want to make it special on
okay.
the top. So here we have a couple of red cinnabar and red. So I'd like you to take this wool, and we're going to do what we did before, laying out the columns,
mm-hmm.
but we're only going to go up to the edge of the template on this last side, so no more sunshine.
Oh,
I know, I'm
sorry. I'm sad about that.
But it's red. It looks pretty
it
cool.
It does.
Anyway. Okay, so we're going to do, I'm beating you again.
Oh, yes. Let me hold that in my left hand. That makes sense.
So I'm just holding the 2 colors side by side. It's an
perfect.
Easy way to do some blending.
Yes.
Okay.
Wow. Okay.
And then I'll let you have a little sunshine, actually, but keep it inside the template. We're not going to
okay.
do anything laying off the edge.
Oh, I see.
Okay, just to add to that
it.
Last little bit of thickness.
Okay.
Okay, and then we're going to do the fun bit. We're going to decorate. So I want mine to look like this pod over here. It looks a bit like an exploding volcano.
Okay. I'll go
so
for
I'd like
a
to find your... Pumpkin. This should
pumpkin.
Be some pumpkin colored wool.
Oh, there's a pumpkin.
Perfect. And then just like you did your starburst earlier, just do a little starburst of your pumpkin wool.
Hmm.
Okay. And later we're going to be cutting a hole here. So we'll lose some of this color. But you should just see the edge of the pumpkin.
Okay.
Okay. And you can do whatever you like. You can add wool yarn here if you want. You can add pre-felt. There's a lot of different things you can use to decorate.
Oh, fun.
And we're going to take a little bit of gold and add a little bit of contrast. So just building
Ooh.
Up our decoration.
This is like the exploding of the hot lava. I feel like this is a campfire.
Oh yeah,
the wood and the fire.
And then we're going to add a little bit of shine. This is some silk, so it looks the same as the wool, but it's a lot softer. And what you're going to do is pull it out the same way, and you want to add it quite finely.
But this one's a little bit tougher to pull out.
Yeah, it is a little bit. Just lay it down the same way. And this won't actually felt by itself, so we're kind of going to what's called glue it to the wool by just putting a tiny little bit more wool on top of it. Okay. And then the wool on top is going to felt to the wool below, and it's going to trap the silk in.
Oh, nice.
But when this dries,
it's kind of glued to my hand.
Woo!
That silk is fun.
Nice. Okay, so then just very, like, so you can't even really see, very few wool fibers on top.
Okay.
I might add a little bit more pumpkin, because that kind of got lost under the gold. Yeah, any kind of fan, and the wool's going to blow everywhere.
Okay. All right. So now what do we do?
Okay.
If we are done.
So there's your decorated side.
All right.
Okay, and then we're going to treat it the same way as we treated the other seven sides.
Okay.
So cover it with the nylon netting. Give you your water back.
All right.
And this time, because we've laid the fibers at slightly different angles in a pattern, we're not going to do our little circles to begin with.
Okay.
We're just going to rub in the direction of the fibers just to get them to felt into the background a little bit, just gently to begin with. Okay. If you go in little circles to begin with, you're going to destroy your pattern.
Okay.
Okay.
This really feels magical.
Yeah.
I am a magician.
You are magician. It's great teaching kids this, actually, especially little boys. They're like blown away by this.
Oh, I bet. Okay, so.
So keep working that into the background. Okay, and then you can, they've felt it into the background now, so you can use your little circles again.
Okay.
Okay. So again, just for a couple of minutes or so.
Mm-hmm.
And then we're going to take the nylon netting off. Again, be careful that you're not pulling your design off.
Okay, there we go.
Okay. And then we're going to see if there's any little rays. We're just going to flip over and wrap them around the outside.
Okay.
And then we are literally ready to roll.
All right. Now, we're rolling, I believe, in these, right?
Is bubble wrap with bubbles up. And what those bubbles are going to do, they kind of massage the wool, so they help felt the pod.
Okay.
And we are going to roll it around the outside of a bamboo mat. And this is just a placemat, actually, or you could use a sushi mat.
Okay.
You're going to roll it up tight. We're not going to put it directly in the bamboo mat just yet, because the felt's too weak right now.
Okay.
So you're going to roll it up tightly.
Okay.
And then using your rubber bands, get them round. Woo! And that's going to happen a few times.
Yep, not that one. You got to
put it around three times if you can, two or three times.
Oh,
you want it tight.
Three times. Okay, so whoops. That one didn't want to stay either. All right. Okay.
All right.
So, and then we're going to start rolling.
We're going to start rolling.
Okay, so it looks like we're going to keep rolling and rolling and rolling. We're going to take another break and show a taste of our home base, 1450 Ocean, the Camera Obscura building, your local community and cultural center that offers workshops in making and movement. It also hosts countless events, and here's a sneak peek.
Thank you.
And believe it or not, that's not everything we do at 1450 Ocean. If you'd like to learn more about what goes on there, please visit our website at smgov.net/1450ocean or visit us on facebook.com/1450ocean/events. You can also find out more about our project today, including a full list of materials and tips. And we're back in the studio with Sara finishing our bowls. And we ended on this process of rolling. Mm-hmm. Now, how do we get from this process to this process?
Okay, well, we did a lot of rolling. So about 4 times 30 rolls with the pod around the outside of the rolling mat. Mm-hmm. And we turn every time between the rolls. We turn it a quarter turn and flip it over. And that's causes the pod to shrink evenly. If you rolled it all in one direction, it's going to be oval. It's going to just shrink in one direction. So we rolled it like this, and once the wool toughened up a bit, we actually laid it still in the bubble wrap inside the bamboo mat, and we rolled it some more.
Okay.
And you roll and roll and roll. It depends from person to person how angry they are, how hard they roll, how quickly it will shrink. But you'll see that the template will start shrinking and buckling up. So we can open this up now and see what we've got. And it should be a bit smaller than what we started with. Here we go. So you can see the direction you rolled in. It shrunk up. And you can see if you can compare it to the original template, how it shrunk down a little bit.
I see.
Okay. And before it gets to this stage, it's going to shrink about 30%.
Okay.
So we're going to cut our opening now. And you've got a few choices. So for this one, I'm aiming to look like this. Okay. So we're going to take your scissors.
Yes.
And we're just going to do a simple circle. So we're going to pinch up the center, find the center of your decoration, pinch up and cut straight down. And you want to cut to the template, don't cut all the way through.
Yeah, how do you not cut the template?
Just go a little bit slowly.
Okay.
Sounds obvious, but somebody cut all the way through once when I was teaching. So I'm going to cut an opening and I can decide how big I want it. It's going to get a little bit bigger, about a quarter of an inch bigger.
Okay.
So I cut about a 2-inch wide circle. Okay, so I'm just gonna, and you can see as you cut it, can you see the different layers?
Oh, yes.
You laid the, and you can see the template in the middle. So this is where it's gonna really start looking like a bowl.
Wow.
Okay, so I've got this my opening.
Amazing. Now, I guess we'll get there when we get there, but
you can see the template.
Sides, how do we get those now super nice?
Okay, we're going to do what's called healing. So we're going to take some undiluted dish soap and just put a little bit on your hands.
Okay.
And we're going to spray the opening a little bit. And then we're just going to pinch the two edges together and just do a little circular motion again. And that's going to pinch those two sides together and give you a really neat edge.
Wow.
And this, like I said, is to make the circular opening.
Yeah.
If you cut across two lines,
okay,
you'd end up with a bursting pod like this.
Oh, yes.
So you can really decide. And then if you want a really bursting open vessel, you can cut. This is 4 lines. Okay, and there's been no shaping. The wool does that by itself.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
But the more you cut, the more you have to heal.
Gotcha.
So we're taking the simple route.
Gotcha.
So we're going to pinch these sides together. And then when you've done that for a couple of minutes, it's time to take your template out. So it's the big reveal.
Yay.
And people think this is super delicate, but you can wrestle this out of here.
Okay.
You've turned it, can you see? You've turned it from wool to a fabric.
Wow, this is amazing.
And here's a lovely beret. No.
Now, is this how you made the jacket as well? This jacket over here?
It's very similar. It's a much bigger template. And actually, this is Nuno felting, which is a combination of wool and silk. So this is silk on the inside, a wool layer, and silk on the outside.
Wow.
And a whole lot more rolling.
A lot of rolling.
Yeah,
yes.
this starts huge, the template.
And a lot of massaging.
That's right,
yes.
Yeah. We won't do that today.
Yes.
Second class.
It's gorgeous. It's gorgeous. Now tell us, I know there's quite a few steps to finish this up to get it to be a bowl like this. Now
okay, well you can see this is a lot bigger. So I've taken the template out, it's already felted, but this got to the point where it was stopping the wool from shrinking anymore.
Okay.
So we close this up and roll it a little bit more directly in the bamboo mat because it's tough enough now.
Mm-hmm.
And that would shrink it down even more.
Okay.
And then we're going to do something, we would do something called shocking the fibers,
mm-hmm.
where you plunge it in hot water and squeeze it and cold water, and then you throw it at the table. Sound like I'm making it up, don't I?
Oh, wow.
And what that does is it gets the fibers to lock up together and it shrinks it up and it really firms up the fabric.
Gotcha. Okay. Oh, wow.
And then the very last step, after mm-hmm. you've rinsed the soap out,
mm-hmm.
you soak it in a little bit of water with white vinegar mm-hmm. to neutralize any soap. And then if you'd like to pass me the pod over there.
Yes. Ooh.
We stuff it with trash bags and because felt will hold the shape that it dries in. So if you want a really smooth pod, you stuff it really tightly with trash bags. If you want a little bit more organic feel,
right.
fewer trash bags.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And then at the end, you can decorate with beading or embroidery, needle felting, whatever you like to
see. That's gorgeous. Wow. Beautiful, beautiful. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Sara, this has been so much fun. We are so grateful to Sara Smelt for joining us today and teaching us a whole new project to experiment with, the art of felting. I don't think I will ever look at felt fabrics the same. I'm ready to make another one. And just a reminder, felting classes are offered at 1450 Ocean. So if you're interested in doing this yourself, just drop us a line. We offer ongoing classes in both making and movement. I want to thank you all for being with us today. We'll see you again here very soon. But before we go, we've covered plenty of making today, but we haven't really moved enough. So I invite you right now to get up wherever you are and join us in our dance party sign off. Yeah.